Hey guys, welcome to another learning session from Watch, Learn, and Play channel. This time I will talk about how to set up a wire bonding process, specifically ball bonding using gold wire. Gold wire bonding is one of the main interconnect processes in semiconductor packaging. It is widely used because it is a proven and stable interconnect process technology, and it is really a high throughput process that is very appropriate in a high volume manufacturing environment. I previously shared three learning videos related to wire bonding process that provided lots of technical information. And this information will now be applied in this next learning video. If you have not watched them yet, I strongly recommend to watch these videos as well. Okay guys, this is Lito Galera and let's start learning. To set up a proper wire bonding process, you need to understand the device or die that you will be bonding. The key information that you need to know regarding the device are bond pad opening or BPO, bond pad pitch or BPP, bond pad composition, the required wire diameter, die size, die thickness, and bonding layout. Top left illustration on this slide shows about BPO and BPP. On the top right, shows how BPO and BPP will affect the choice of capillary that should be used. On the bottom left shows how die thickness may affect loop height setup. A thicker die would leave less space to the top of the package, thus limiting the allowable loop height. With a thinner die, there is more room for a higher loop height. This slide shows variations in bonding layout. The illustration on the left shows a simple bonding layout wherein the bond pads are almost perfectly lined up opposite the leads. With this layout, the wire spans are generally shorter and do not require special looping parameters. The illustration on the right shows a bonding layout where some of the wires are on an angle away from the bond pad and also passing close to the edge of the adjacent bond pad and a longer wire span. Once you know your device, it is now time to select your bonding capillary. In general, there are two types of capillary based on how the capillary tip is shaped. First is the standard capillary, wherein the tip has a conical shape, typically with the main taper angle or MTA of 30 degrees. The second type is the bottleneck capillary. The tip is also a cone shape, but with the secondary shape that is slimmer than the standard tip shape. More illustrations on this slide using a bottleneck capillary. You see how capillary tip diameter should be relative to BPP. In general, capillary tip should be less than 2 times BPP to have enough gap to the adjacent wires. And also note the required bottleneck height or BNH relative to the loop height. Die size and thickness will affect wire span and loop height respectively. Wire span will affect selection of wire type. A long wire span would require steeper wire than normal. And finally, wire diameter will determine the capillary hole diameter. This slide shows the capillary tip dimensions. Chamfer diameter or CD and chamfer angle or CA mainly affects the first bond. CD affects the mashable diameter or MBD. A small MBD requires a small CD, and a larger ball would require to use a larger CD. You will need to note that MBD must be less than the device BPO. CA affects the bonded ball shape. Typical chamfer angles are 70 degrees, 90 degrees, and 120 degrees. The illustration on the left compares the bonded ball shape between a 70 degree and a 120 degree CA. The second bond or stitch is mainly affected by face angle or FA, outside radius or OR, and tip diameter or T. Standard FA are 0 degree, 4 degrees, 8 degrees, and 11 degrees. FA affects the thickness of stitch. I would recommend to start with FA of 8 degrees. as it is not too thick and can compensate for higher second bond parameter if necessary. T dictates the stitch length, which is typically half of the T. OR dictates the profile of the stitch. It's time to talk about machine setup. In a production environment, the wirebond process is typically done using a semi-automatic or a fully automatic machine. The main difference between a semi-automatic and a fully automatic machine is the magazine handling system. A fully automatic machine has an input and output magazine handling system. The devices for bonding, typically in a strip or panel form, are placed inside the magazine and onto the input handling system, and then transported to the bond site where the actual bonding process happens, and out to the output handling system without operator intervention. A semi-automatic machine has no input and output handling system. The devices for bonding are placed manually onto the bonding site one at a time and also unloaded manually by the operator after the bonding process is complete. The bonding process happens at the center of the machine, which includes the heater block, the XY table, bond head, wirepage system, and the electronic flame up unit. These parts of the machine shall be discussed in this learning video as we go through the steps of setting up a wire bonding process. Before a bonding process can be set up, the machine itself must be first set up and calibrated. XY table controls the bond placement. With the very small bond pad, the XY movement accuracy is critical. Otherwise, the bonded ball placement will be inconsistent or misplaced and partly overshoot outside of the bond pad area, which will cause bond shorting issues. The bond head, which carries the transducer and bonding capillary, controls the said movement during bonding, which means it controls the consistency of bonded ball thickness or flatness. Transducer frequency will depend on machine manufacturer and model, typically 60 or 120 kHz. Both the XY table and bond head must be calibrated or tuned before setting up the process. You should refer to the machine manual for proper procedure to do the calibration or tuning process. One of the key parameters in ball bonding is the bonding temperature. Heater block is key in ensuring correct bonding temperature throughout the bonding process. The heater block temperature is calibrated by measuring the actual temperature and compare it against the specs. The temperature measurement must be done with a window clamp and insert installed and in a closed position using a calibrated thermometer. A deviation within a plus minus 5 degrees C to the target temperature is typically acceptable. I would reiterate to use a calibrated thermometer for this activity. A higher temperature than the specs may cause damage to laminate substrate, particularly for BGA packages. Too much heat will also cause oxidation on copper-based lead frame. But of course, a higher temperature will increase material bondability. A lower temperature may not cause substrate damage or lead frame oxidation, but it makes bonding a little bit more difficult. It is now time to install the capillary. While capillary installation may look simple, it can create a lot of problems if not done properly. The illustration shows a typical transducer and capillary. The capillary is installed or clamped at the end of the transducer using a clamp screw. However, the screw must be tightened at a certain torque and must be inspected or replaced after a certain number of times the capillaries change. This is because the clamp screw affects the transducer tuning or calibration. A worn-out screw will result to higher transducer impedance and will likely affect application of ultrasonic power during bonding process. Make sure to follow bonding machine manufacturer instructions for installing capillary and transducer tuning or calibration. For proper bond placement, it is very important that the capillary tip and camera crosshair are, as much as possible, perfectly aligned. When you create a bond program, you use the crosshair to teach the bond placement. And when you do the actual bonding, the center of the capillary will land on the crosshair. So if the capillary is off-centered to the crosshair, then the bond placement will not be correct. Every time you change the capillary to camera offset should be taught. A quick illustration is shown on this slide. A capillary mark or impression is done on a bondable surface. Initially, the capillary mark will be off-centered to crosshair. After adjustment, the capillary should be aligned to the crosshair. It's time to talk about bonding trials. To do bonding trials, obviously, you need some materials to bond. Ideally, you would like to bond on actual dye, but not the electrically good dye. Only the ink dyes with good bondable bond pads. If ink dyes are not available, using just the lead frame or substrate is also acceptable. Using the available bonding material, you can now create the bond program. And also, just use a standard loop profile for simple and easier bonding trials. The main goal of the bonding trial is to make it stick. Make it stick. Well, needless to say, a successful bond means the first bond or gold ball stick onto the aluminum bond pad, and the second bond or stitch stick onto the lead. Likewise, you can't do much if any of the bonds do not stick. For initial bonding trials, making the first and second bond stick is the first goal. And from there, you can play around with the parameters until you meet the bonding specs for both visual, bond shear, and pull tests. Let's now talk about how to make the bond stick by understanding the fundamentals of bonding process. First bond is the bonding of free air ball to the bond pad. A bond pad is a small area of thin layer of aluminum. First bond requires a small amount of force to press the free air ball onto the bond pad, followed by ultrasonic power to form the bond between two materials. The bond is a very thin gold aluminum intermetallic layer, and the strength of the bond depends on the amount of intermetallic formed. The bond intermetallic is formed within the contact area between the bonded or mesh ball and bond pad. The larger the mesh ball, the larger the contact area, and the higher percentage of intermetallic formed. More intermetallic means higher bond strength, which is ideal in the bonding process. Let's examine the bonded ball after the first bond is complete. The bonded ball or mesh ball diameter is typically should be in the range of 2 times to 4 times of wire diameter, or nominal 3 times wire diameter. For example, if you are using a 1 mil wire diameter, the target nominal diameter is 3 mils. Just to note, 1 mil is equivalent to 25 microns, therefore 3 mils is equivalent to 75 microns. On the mesh ball diameter limit, it is possible that it is a larger than bond pad opening, or BPO. It is critical that the mesh ball diameter be within the BPO. Otherwise, there is a risk of bond shorting to adjacent pad or wire. On the low side of the limit, while 2 times wire diameter will very likely be inside the bond pad, it is likely will result to a lower bond strength because the contact area will be smaller. Because of the inherent shape of the bonded ball, the contact area is always smaller than the mesh ball diameter. Also, the bonded ball height should be around 0.6 to 0.8 times of wire diameter. there is no universal bond parameter settings. Parameters need to be defined throughout bonding trials. While there are many bonding parameters, depending on equipment manufacturer, the primary parameters are bond force, ultrasonic power, and time. Learning how to play these parameters is very important and definitely will help you successfully set up your bonding process. The second bond is the bonding of the wire onto the lead, which completes the bonding sequence. Similar to first bond, bond force is applied to press the wire onto the lead and using ultrasonic power to form the bond. Because the second bond is on the lead, which is a much harder material compared to aluminum bond pad, it requires a much higher bond force and ultrasonic power to make the proper bond. The second bond strength is relative to the contact area of the wire to the lead, which is limited by the wire diameter, capillary tip size and shape, and bond force. Let's examine the details of a completed second bond. One side of capillary is pressed onto the wire by the application of bond force. This forms the fishtail of the second bond as shown on the image. The lead surface will also have the capillary tip impression, showing that sufficient bond force was applied during bonding. Notice how the shape and size of capillary affects the formation of second bond fishtail. Also note that second bond is also called stitch. If too much bond force is applied on the second bond, the stitch will be smaller and the capillary impression is deeper, shattered. In some cases, this will also result to a lifted stitch problem because the fishtail that is left on the lead is too small. Or if the stitch is not lifting, the tail end formation after second bond will be inconsistent and will cause a frequent or occasional EFO error when forming the prior ball. A poor second bond will also result to a low pull test results. Finally, let's talk about wire bond process quality requirements. This will apply only if you bond using actual dies. First, the visual quality. Bonded ball and stitch placement must be within the bond pads and leads consistently, and placement should not vary between devices. For first bond, make sure there's no gold clubbing, which means the wire must exit from the center of the bonded ball. Otherwise, it will look like a gold club. Next are the destructive tests, which are bond shear and pull tests. You can refer to JEDEC standard JESD22-B116 for bond shear tests and MIL standard 83 method 2011 for bond pull tests. Lastly, you can do a bond crater test for first bond to check for oxide damage underneath the bond pad. That concludes our Wirebond process setup learning video. Feel free to drop a comment or send me an email if you have questions related to this topic. To support my channel, please do not forget to subscribe, like, and share this channel. Thank you for watching.